It's now my happy privilege to present to you Reverend Jack Coe, internationally known evangelist. Through his positive faith in God, he has brought deliverance to thousands of sick and suffering people. Reverend Coe has preached in many of the nation's largest auditoriums and in the world's largest gospel tent for many years. He is founder of the Texas, a wonderful home for homeless children. And now coming to you direct from one of his great healing and deliverance revivals, the man with a spirit-anointed message for you, Evangelist Jack Coe.
I'm happy to be here in this all air-conditioned building. Hot air in the summer, cold in the winter. But we have Jesus here, don't we? To begin with, I'm going to take off my coat, if you don't object. And if you fellas want to, you can take off yours. You look all right. Say amen. Can you feel his presence? Say amen. How many is glad you're here tonight? Say amen. How many would rather be here and be in jail? Say amen. Thank you. Rest of you ought to went to jail, you'd have been happier. Now to begin with, I'm not a DD, and I'm not a PhD. But I read in the Bible one time where the Lord spoke to a donkey. And ever since that time, I've been trying to preach. It doesn't matter what we say, just as long as God anoints it. Peter heard a rooster crow one time, and it was so anointed of God that he fell down on his face and prayed through. If I don't do anything tonight but just give you a good anointed crow and can get a bunch of you to pray through, that's all I'm here for anyhow. In the sermon I'm going to preach tonight, I'm going to do one of my best to do one of the three things to you. To either make you mad, sad, or glad. I believe if a man preaches the word of God, it'll do one of the three things. It'll either make him mad, sad, or glad. So you that are used to sleeping, you go ahead and sleep and don't let me bother you. I've been in church lots of times when I was so sleepy that I could hardly hold my eyes open, and I'd sit there and fan myself and tickle myself and pinch myself. And I never got anything out of the sermon or my sleep either. I'd have been better off if I'd have went to sleep. At least I'd have got something out of one of them. So if you can't stay awake tonight, you go ahead and sleep and don't let me bother you. Before I start preaching, I'd like to have everybody stand and sing with me, "I Got Peace Like a River." Come on, everybody stand. If you don't know this, it won't take you long to learn. Well, I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. Well, I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. Well, I've got peace like a river. I've got peace. pretty good for a consumption ward, but pretty bad for a bunch of people that's filled with the Holy Ghost. Some people around here remind me of the Electrolux refrigerator ad. They used to advertise always cold with no moving parts to wear out. A small gas flame does the work. One of those ice boxes caught on fire in our hometown and burned up, and that thing never would freeze ice cubes after that. How many's got peace like a river in your heart tonight? Put your hand up high. Well, come on, clap them hands and say it. And brother, smile, will you do it? Things is not as bad as you think they are. Besides, they might get worse. All together, everybody. Be seated if you can. I just closed a six-week revival meeting in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. We were in the Metropolitan Opera House. Night after night, the building was packed to capacity, and many nights, as many as 10,000, the police department said, standing on the streets that couldn't get in. Sometimes we closed the doors at 6:15. We didn't open them until 6 o'clock, and in 15 minutes, the building was packed to capacity, and the doors had to be closed. Many people came as early as 5:30 in the morning and sit there all day waiting for the doors to open. When you can get people to go to church at 5:30 in the morning and sit there and wait until 6 o'clock in the evening, there's a revival in the land. We saw people leave their crutches, leave their wheelchairs, and out of 93 people brought in by ambulance laying all over the platform of the great Metropolitan Opera House. I never pray for anybody behind a curtain. I put them all out where you can see them. I believe if Jesus does something, then you can praise God for what he does. And out of 93 brought in by ambulance, all but 16 of them left their ambulance beds and walked home. Hallelujah. God healed paralytics, opened blind eyes. One Methodist man that I prayed for in New Jersey had a cancer on his face. That cancer fell off in my hand. I showed it to the minister sitting on the platform. That man came night after night when he went back and told his pastor and showed his pastor that the cancer was gone. The pastor said, I wouldn't believe it even if it is gone. And he said, well, the best thing for me to do is find someplace else to go to church. He said, I've got to go someplace where people believe in the fullness of the moving of the power of God. Hallelujah. God is moving in the land today. Our brother Hicks just told about the great revival that he had, and it stirred my heart to think that 100,000 people, stirred by the gospel of Jesus Christ in one single night. I'm sure tomorrow night that if you come to hear Brother Branham, he's a man of God, anointed of God. God is not letting this thing decrease, but increase. All of our opposers would like to think it's decreasing. But I'll tell you, God is not only raising up preachers to pray the prayer of faith, but he's raising up everybody that'll believe and lay hands on the sick. And as I walked in, I saw Brother Gardner sitting here, and I saw some of the most marvelous miracles under a businessman's hands as I have any preacher. God's anointing everybody that'll humble themselves and accept what God's got for them. How many believe that? Say amen. Bible didn't say these signs shall follow only the preachers, but the Bible said these signs shall follow them that believe. The last convention I preached in Los Angeles for the full gospel businessmen, it was my privilege to preach on that God was going to heal the whole body of Christ before he come after him again. I know I have a lot of people that disagree with that, but I believe I have enough Bible to back it up. I believe God is pouring out his spirit. Here a while back I was laying at home. I said, God, what's going to be the difference between this last day revival and the first revival? How much greater is the last day revival going to be? A lot of preachers are going around preaching it's too late to win souls. It's too late to have a revival. All you can do is get the church ready. But I'll tell you, the church will be far more ready seeing lost souls saved and sick bodies healed than any other way we can get the church of the living God. And I was laying there praying, God, how much greater is this last revival going to be? God said to me, Jack, when you was a child, you looked up into the heavens. What was the first thing you looked for? And I said, God, I looked for the Little Dipper. We always found the Little Dipper first. God said, what did you look for next? And I said, God, as children, we always tried to find the Big Dipper. God said the first outpouring of Pentecost was like the Little Dipper. And the last outpouring of my spirit upon the face of the earth is going to be like the Big Dipper. He said, I dumped the little one first. Now I'm getting ready to dump the big one. And the rain is going to come down the size of a pencil. Somebody said, is that latter rain? Yes, latter rain, middle rain, early rain. Rain, Assembly of God, Church of God, Catholics, Jews, Methodists. God's going to pour out his spirit upon all flesh. The black, the white, the red, the yellow. God's going to pour out his spirit upon all flesh. I'll never forget when I first got saved. I didn't know what the word glory or hallelujah was. I belonged to a church that didn't believe in saying hallelujah unless you sung it out of a hymn book. But I got saved one night in an old Nazarene church. When God spoke peace to my heart, I jumped up out of that altar. I didn't know how to say glory, hallelujah. All I knew was hot dog. I jumped up and I ran all over that church hollering, hot dog, I've got it. He said, you have to act like that to get it. No, but if you get enough of the right thing, you'll act some way. I went home. I walked in. I woke my mom up. I said, oh, Mom, I got saved. Mother stood up in bed and said to my dad, he's drunk again. I said, no, Mom, I'm not drunk. I got saved. She said to my dad, you better put him to bed. He's drunk. He got me in the living room, tried to take my clothes off, and I was waving my hands, hollering, hot dog, I got saved. She said, son, you're not still drunk this morning, are you? I said, no, Mama, I'm not drunk. I got saved. She said, Dr. Conkright's going to get tired of baptizing you. I said, I didn't get baptized. I got that there saved business. She said, what do you mean that saved business? I said, I don't know. I said, them people down there that they call holy rollers done something to me. I said, Mama, I got something you ain't got. You said nothing, now you better shut your mouth. But brother, you can't shut up anybody that's got it. If you shut this thing up, the thing would explode and get all red. You just gotta let it go. Man, I went out in the morning singing. I committed night singing. I went to church every night because they had church every night in the Nazarene church then. That was before the Nazarenes had lost the joy. Quiet in here. But I went out shouting and come in shouting and singing. About 6 or 8 weeks went by, and my mama said one day, one evening to me, said, where are you going? I said, to church. She said, son, that's all you do is go to church. Well, I said, Mama, when I went to the honky-tonks and hell holes, you never said nothing. What's wrong with me going to church? She said, but son, don't you think you've lost your mind over religion? I said, Mama, if I have, it's wonderful. And I hope you lose yours right away, sir. She said, I'll tell you one thing. Me and your dad's going with you tonight. We're going to find out what they've done to you. Jesus. Oh, thank you, Jesus. We got under that old tent. Preacher preached, and when the altar call was made, my mother turned to my dad and said, are you go? He said, no. She said, get out of my way. I said, I've got to go. Down the aisle, that old gray-haired mother of mine went, fell in them shavings and began to cry and pray. My mother's 72 years old. Her hair's turned white. I'll never forget her prayer as long as I live. She belonged to the Baptist church for years, but she didn't know how to pray. But she got out there, and I'll never forget what she prayed. She just hollered, oh, God, give me what God's got. I don't know what he's got, God, but whatever it is, I've got to have it. God, I can't sleep. I can't eat. Down there hollering, God, give me what Jack's got, until all of a sudden, up she'd come with tears rolling down her cheeks and a smile on her face, and she said, Jack, I've got it. I've got it. I know what's the matter with you now. I've got it. And I reached out, and me and my mother stood there and hugged each other. And after we kind of quieted down, it was on Saturday night, we had to go buy the groceries. We went down to the grocery store, one of those chain stores, and I got the basket, and she was picking up the groceries, and I was pushing the basket. By that time, my stepdad was so ashamed of both of us, he'd gone home, went to bed. That's what he said. But he was just so miserable, he couldn't stay around us. We was picking up, she was picking up the groceries, and I was pushing the basket, and I think it was a big can of tomatoes she picked up, and she said, you know, she said, that reminds me of the blood of Jesus was applied to my sin. Brother, when she said that, I was gone. I started shouting. grocery store quit working and people quit moving. To watch an old lady and her boy shout all over that grocery store. When I quit shouting and kind of come to myself, I was over by the meat counter. There stood the meat man with the apron in his hands, wiping the tears away from his face. And he looked at me and he said, you've been up there at that tent, haven't you? I said, oh. He said, my wife went up there 3 or 4 nights ago and got one of them treatments, and he said, I said, yeah.
The healings you are about to witness are the actual healings as they took place in the great Jack Cole meeting in Washington, D.C.
Eardrum's completely gone. How many believe God can put an eardrum in an ear? Here it comes right now. Lord, in thy name. That's it. Stop if you get here.
Thank you, Jesus.
Say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
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 Praise the Lord.
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 Hallelujah.
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 Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Get here again.
I'm just talking to you like that.
But if I talk like that, you'd really hear it. I can feel it. Not that. Give me 3 or 4 and come feel this to me. I'd rather not have preachers. Give me somebody out of the congregation. Come on. Methodist or Baptist? Right in here. I'd rather have you out of the congregation. Come on, 2 or 3 out of the congregation. 2 or 3 out of the congregation, please. Stand right here.
Yes, Lord.
Feel right in here.
I don't feel anything.
Box has a bigger app.
Inside. Can you feel it? That's about it. Stand right here. Jesus, in thy name I charge you to take this old tumor out of here, God. Remove it for thy glory and thy name. Let every bit of this swelling go away for Jesus' sake. Amen. Feel up there for what you said. Wait a minute. Can you feel anything there now?
I don't think so.
You feel it. Dislocated, Mother? Whereabouts? That's where the spine's dislocated, right in there. Right there? God, in my leg, loose this back, God, for your glory. You have a brace on your back? Support of any kind?
Yes.
Go back in the women's room, take the sport off and throw it away. You never need it again. Raise your hands and praise God. Right in there, where it hurts you.
Yeah, right.
Right there! Lord, in thy name, God, loose it. Feel it now, see if it hurts you now. You even feel the tumor anymore.
I feel it a little.
You feel it a little? Say praise God, never a bit of it go away.
Praise God, hallelujah! Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Feel again now.
So happy to be on this television program and to come to you each week and to show you what God is doing throughout the world today, how he's healing the sick. How the lame are being made to walk, the blind are being made to see, and the deaf hear. I'm not a healer. I never claimed to be a healer. I believe there's only one healer, and his name's Jesus. But the Bible said all that came to Jesus was healed. We do not claim to heal any of these people, but it's a prayer of faith that I pray for them. God sent me out and gave me power over sickness, over disease, over the works of the devil. And he told me whatever I bound on earth would be bound in heaven. Whatever I loosed on earth would be loosed in heaven. So I want you to sit down and write me a letter today if you're enjoying these programs. And tell me how much you're enjoying. If you'd like to have me pray for your sick body, all you have to do is just write me a letter. And say, Brother Cope, please pray for my sick body. And I know God will heal you. Friends, you don't have to suffer. You don't have to go through pain and agony. When doctors have folded their hands and said there's nothing more they can do, thank God Jesus can do something for you. So write me a letter today and I'll pray the prayer of faith that'll set you free from that old cancer, heal you of that old tumor, open them blind eyes. To everyone that writes me a letter, I'm going to send you one of these little gold prayer cloths that I've prayed over and believed God over. And when you get this gold prayer cloth, you lay it upon your sick body and God will heal you of that sickness and affliction. And also I'm going to send you my book on Wilt Thou Be Made Whole. Now these will come to you just by writing me a letter. This is a 39-page book on how to receive your healing from God. God will heal you, friend, if you'll only write me a letter and let me pray for you. Write me today. Don't let another day go by. I need to hear from you, and you need to hear from God. If you'll write me, I'll send you the gold prayer cloth and the book.
Write Brother Coe this week for his fine offer. Address, Reverend Jack Coe, Box 8596 or 8538. God bless you till we meet again next week at this same time.